A hot Jupiter is a Jupiter-sized planet on a very short orbital period of just a few days, an orbital separation that is 10 times smaller than that of Mercury's. One way that we can try and understand these planets is via observations of their atmospheres, which is precisely what we're doing via the JWST ERS program.
For me, hot Jupiters are so interesting because you're taking something very familiar. We have a Jupiter in our own solar system, and then you're just flinging it all the way next to its star. And so in a sense, you're sort of doing a little science experiment, but on this cosmic scale of like, what happens if you put Jupiter here?
WASP-39b is a very good target to study because it is the size of Jupiter, a size, I mean, radius of Jupiter, but it only has like half the mass of Jupiter. So we call it puffy. This puffiness kind of makes extended atmosphere basically makes it easier to detect things in there. So that just the signals are very large.
When we take our telescope and point it at the star, you see the planet cross between us and the starlight. If we observe that at many different wavelengths, we can get an understanding of what is actually in the atmosphere, because you have certain chemical species that are absorbing at specific wavelengths. That's really one of the best ways to understand what's actually in the planetary atmosphere.
So for WASP-39b, we already had Hubble and ground-based data, so we knew it was an interesting planet. We knew it had water in its atmosphere. So we kind of already knew going in that it was going to be fruitful, anything we looked at. Maybe we didn't know exactly what to expect, but we knew we would see something.
And so we felt like we had a pretty good chance to observe some remarkable molecular gas species in the infrared with JWST.
The idea behind the early reading science was to be able to get kind of like a benchmark observations that the community basically used to then propose for new time, you know, have an idea what the data looks like. And because it's not just one instrument that can be used for exoplanet science, but all instruments, we decided to try all of them and to try to get a feeling for how each one of the instruments works.
Each of the instruments has a different wavelength coverage, which really highlights the power of observing the same planet with all of those different wavelengths, because if you go from nearest in the like optical near infrared all the way out to the farthest wavelengths of prism, you really get a sense of all the kind of species that you can cover with these JWST instruments.
When I was first working with JWST data, my first impression was that I knew that we had something remarkable.
I did the WASP-39b data for the first time. I brought my laptop around to show people. This is one of the best parts about being a scientist. There's something unexpected.
It was just such a beautiful, continuous data set that you can really resolve all of the kinds of features that papers had been talking about for years.
Yeah, it was the best Thursday afternoon of my life.
I couldn't sleep for a couple of days. I was so excited and I couldn't wait to see what everybody else had got and to sort of share it with the team.
This spectrum was being reduced just in front of me by a colleague of mine. He rushed with his laptop with this plot.
We saw this gorgeous CO2 feature exactly where we expected it to be, and it had this other little bump that by eye at first look was very clear in the data. I was like, I don't know what that is. We just kept gathering more and more of a crowd around us, all hunched over Zafar's laptop, the theorists kind of talking past each other like, there's a weird extra bump here, what is it?
Everyone was really confused. We had a large number of atmospheric models, but the surprising thing was that none of those large number of models could actually reproduce this feature. The whole team pooled their expertise, people who had stared at molecular barcodes, the signatures of gases for years and years, and very soon SO2 became a prominent candidate.
Yeah, my biggest surprise is SO2 detection, for sure. We didn't expect the SO2, which is a relatively minor sulfur species, can be clearly detected in exoplanetary atmospheres.
Things like SO2 can actually form if we consider the high energy radiation from the star, and those photons can dissociate gases in the upper atmosphere, and that can lead to a whole new set of chemical reactions.
So because of the SO2 detection, the atmosphere also contains abundant sulfur as well. Abundant sulfur indicates the planet presumably experienced significant accretions of planetesimals that can deliver the sulfur to the atmosphere The data also indicates that the oxygen is much more abundant than carbon. In other words, the carbon to oxygen ratio is relatively low. This potentially indicates that the WASP-39b was originally formed that far away from the central star.
We know where Jupiter is in our solar system, but we're seeing these hot Jupiters that are much closer, perhaps these type of planets from very far away, and then they move towards their star. We call this migration. We're trying to paint a picture of how did this planet migrate, what sort of conditions were they in where they migrated, and we're playing detective. We're trying to reconstruct their history. Our investigation of the K2O ratio of WASP-39 strongly suggests that there seems to be a larger ratio of potassium to oxygen than it is expected. If WASP-39 indeed has a supersolar K2O ratio, that means that in this particular case, it would have eaten more alkalis, more potassium, than it ate components that had oxygen or water, for example. These type of measurements allow us to understand where planets formed, but also how they migrated into their current positions, so that we can kind of like put that as a context for the more complex story of planet formation.
I think for me, the best part of being involved in the ERS program has been working with this incredibly large and incredibly talented team of people from across the globe that draws scientists from all career stages.
I have this thought and I have a question. I'm like, oh, I can go ask this person because they're part of this team and I can draw on all of that knowledge and we can synthesize it together. And that's just been so much fun.
Large collaborations are the way of the future.
You know, we chose as an ERS team, like a fairly easy target to observe. A hot Jupiter, so its atmosphere is very good for transmission spectroscopy, but pushing down towards Neptune, sub-Neptune-sized planets, terrestrial planets, you know, I think we have to wait and see what the future really holds.
So this makes me very hopeful that within the next few years, JWST will completely change our understanding of exoplanetary atmospheres.
I think that we are really at the dawn of an amazing new era of exoplanet atmosphere science.
I'm so excited about the next 20 years when we start seeing planets that do not fit our perceptions of what nature should be.